A lecture series put on by the history department here at KCU. I just want to thank everyone for coming. Obviously, we have a very full room today, which is nice. And we're very pleased, very thankful to have Herta Heine with us here. I won't tell her about won't tell you about her life story. I'll let her do that. But a lady who has lived a remarkable life, and not only read about history as many of us do, but lived through some of the most momentous events of the 20th century. So if you would, welcome Herta Heine, and let's hear what she has to say.
Hello, everybody. If anybody has questions or can hear me right, please say so. And where do I going to start now?
Everybody
knows.
How old were you when World War II started?
When we was in school, I was 9 years old. And yeah, now I'm stuck. Yeah, from there on, it was very, very scary. We had to do as we were told, and then we start training about marching, how to march, and got gathered together and all that. And I'm blanking out. Yeah, but then when the war camp came closer and all that, the bombs and the planes, we had to go into the bomb shelters. We built a shelter for nighttime. Daytime, whenever we had to, and sometimes we could not go in the bomb shelter, so we had to go in the basement because it was too close and too scary. And a lot of people from the town, they came towards us, and they wanted to bury stuff for safety. But there were really, then the police came around and they were looking around where things were buried, and where the ground was lifted up, and so that was not safe either, but at least they didn't find nothing. We never did anything like that. And during the nighttime, it was the worst. We always had to be ready for dress up and getting ready to go outside when the bombs came, when the planes came around. And then, yeah, that was later, so for that.
That's okay.
Just take
your time.
So there was nothing, we could buy nothing in the store. The stores was empty, and clothing, and so we had to make whatever we could get material and find something. And I needed a coat, and I had to my aunt for making it for me. And then I had to go there on the bicycle. That's all we had. We had no transportation, but you walk or you're on a bicycle. And then when I came home, on the way home, there was a plane up in the air. And it was following me. And I said, where should I go? Out of town? What should I do? Where do I go? And should I go faster? Should I go slow? Should I turn around? And out of town, there was a farmer, and he was just leaving the fields. Well, he didn't talk to me, I didn't talk to him. And I was scared for this plane to come around, and was still on top and following me. And I went, and I said to myself, what should I do? Where I go? Turn around, he's gonna shoot, and he's gonna shoot in town. So I kept going. I had to go a couple of miles down the road, and then I had to make a left turn into the woods. And here, I turn in, and hear the bullets flying around. They go in front of me, in back of me, right for me, and the left. And I said, which one hit me? And I said, no. I said, what am I going to do? I don't feel it right away when you get hit. And here it comes. And I went on, and I thought, we go through the woods now. Where's the plane going to go? I said, can you meet me on the other end? But no, the plane left. And when I come home, I told my father about it, And he says, now this can't happen. They wouldn't shoot at single people. So then there were 3 days later, he says, yeah, you were right. The same place I was, they were shooting people. And single people on the fields working. So then a couple of weeks later, I was in the field, in the raspberry field, and tied the canes down. And here come 3 planes. I said, oh, now they ours. They wouldn't be here no more. But now they had captured Americans on the and in town. I could see from town far away where I saw them that they were going, but I didn't know who they were. And there were horses and a lot of people walking. And then before I knew, the plane came this way, was in front of me, this way, and all the, had all the smoke behind it. I didn't hear the noise, but I saw the horses going up in the air. And I said, oh no, I said, down I went, up and in the ground. And a couple of days later, I heard there were 2 Americans killed. And I said, oh no, I only knew the names. I could tell them, undoubtedly, American plane shot American people, the American soldiers. But that's war. You know, you never know what can happen there from time to time. So then, but from there on, I was not allowed to go in that field no more. So that was very, very scary. Now we had to go to Montana on a mission trip. And here in one store we went, what was there? There's a plane. And I said, oh, I freaked out. And then I couldn't go back in the store no more from there on. And we have pictures from all that on the table there. We couldn't take no pictures. We had no cameras. They didn't exist. Or they put on the and have the films done. Where are you gonna go? There was nothing around. And and what happy on food and stuff like that. The stores were empty. We had stamps. Stamps what we could have. And they were all by grams. And they had to last for a whole month. But we had farmers. And so we had a little bit to go, but we were never really hungry, but a lot of things what we couldn't get. But other people from town, from the city, they came late around. They were things there was, and they had nothing to eat either. They were got bombed out. And all these bombs, there was a voice during the night that came then after, just before. And we went outside to see all the, what, they couldn't go in the bunkers and things. We were just watching. When hungry, we looked there over at all the planes, fire was just about daylight. All the planes were on fire. We were shut down and coming down, and that was a bad sight to see. We never were safe all the way around.
And you're in your family.
We were 7 in the family. My brother, he was in the war too, and he got. And he came home in 49. But before that and all that, so we had to. No, he was my yeah, my brother. He was in Russia. Then he got wounded. He was lucky. He got shot right beyond his eyes, right below, just a millimeter, shot off his nose. But he had to go back, and he was sent to Russia when he was healed up. And then he was in prison. He was in prison since 49 before he came home. Yeah, I have to go back in there. Yeah, when the war started and all that, and we had to be so strict. We had to say to one person we would say good day, and the other person we say hi Hitler. And you had always stretch out your arm. You a lot of times it goes like this. Nope, we had to go and say hi Hitler. Yeah, they were very, very, we were very strict with everybody. You couldn't talk to nobody. You're not allowed to say anything. You didn't know you're going to be there at night. In the morning when you woke up, is everybody here? Nobody took you. You never know in what kind of camp, where you had to go, when did you pick you up, and what you were saying. Yeah, we had the camps, it was just about everywhere, and you never know. Nobody knew what was going on. We had no telephone. We had no power. There was something after we had about 1 hour they would give us, 1 hour a day where we could use some power and then do what you have to do. Yeah, no radio. We had radio for a while, but not everybody had radio, but we had. And so then I was monkeying with that one and put extra wires in that I could hear from far away what was going on. It had some news here and there. Other than that, we had nothing. We couldn't communicate with nobody. We had no telephones. A lot of people didn't have it. I forgot some of it, I think.
Can you tell us about the village that you grew up in?
Yeah, there's only a few. That's really nice. We had a town where I grew up in, it's two houses, and there's still two houses. And the town is a little bit further, about a mile away from you. There's a kilometer we go. And we had to school, we had to walk. Even there was snow, was no matter how high it was, the schools never closed. The schools never closed. It was always open, only maybe for holidays. And then for summertime, then we had to work in the grain field or help them. And in the fall for potatoes and stuff like that, we had to get in. Otherwise, then it never closed. We were always walking to church, about 5 kilometers. A lot of times, they didn't have a bicycle, you walk. Yeah. I want to go straight on.
can you tell us a little bit about how you heard about the end of the war?
Yeah, but towards the end, that was really scary, too. We had missiles flying over the house constantly and all day long, and we would be in the house. We were not allowed out the house. In the morning, you had field work to do, then you go out 4 o'clock to 7. Because it never gets really dark in Germany. You can see all night through. Yes, you go and see all night. In the winter time, it's very dark.
So how did you hear about the end of the war?
And then, by the end, we were scared. We didn't know exactly when it's ended, but it should come. Then it's stopped. The shooting, it got quieter. And then the prisoners, they got let loose, and they come around, and then they would come to the houses. In Lubeni, they were looking for liquor, more liquor and stuff. And then they come in with guns, right? And so one was outside with a gun, and the others were inside. The line was up against the wall. Now who's going to be shot first? And then a couple, they would go to the house, what they could find, what they needed. That was very scary. Now, who was going to be shot first? Who's going to be living, right? Yeah.
How old were you when the war
first
ended?
When the war ended, I was 14. 14.
What made you come to the States?
Yes, after, yeah. And then in 45, then everything lit up. And just before, we had electricity back. And then everything slowly went back to normal the way it used to be. But all the damage with the bombs and the war did to us. And then 46, then was really everything got alive. Then all the dance floors, everything came back to life. And that's when we start dancing and learn how to dance. But you could not go on a dance floor unless you knew how to dance. You had to go to dance classes. You had to be dressed properly. Yeah, otherwise you couldn't go in. You couldn't dance, you could not go on the dance floor. And then slowly, that was slowly all forgotten, and nobody would even talk about the war no more. But there were now all the people who didn't come back, and who did come back, they had to go through the same thing. And we lost, like my brother, he lost all his friends and all his classmates from the sea, all died in the war.
And then later.
Then, I missed some out there.
Don't worry about it. Did you get to the States,
Mom? Yes.
Okay.
Sure.
I have a question.
Yes.
You would have been really young, but I want to know if you could remember how your parents felt about Hitler before the war started.
We really didn't know exactly how he felt, because nobody talked about it.
Okay.
Nobody really talked about it. I don't think nobody really liked it. But we had to. It was not bad for a while, but when the war started, when they put all the camps up, which that was very bad. Nobody knew about it. We don't know its exact truth. We don't know what's written out, what they talk about it. Nobody really knows the real truth. We never found out. No, yeah, that's the bad part. Yes. You have something too?
Did any of your family members get shot during the war?
No. I was the only one in the picture here right now. Yeah, unless my brother, he was in the war, yeah. He never talks about it. All veterans, they don't, what happened, they go so far, they don't. There's memories you don't want to talk about. But you hear certain noises, you right back in it. Then you go where you are, you down on the floor. That stays with you. I'd want to forget, but you can't. You can't forget that. Especially when they after the war, then everything opens up on the camps. Here's a camp, there's a camp. I was too young then. They didn't take me, but they took my twin brother. He had to go in there and clean up. And he would have been the next one on line to draft to go to war. And then he would go over 65. They go younger, and they were going to go older. There was nobody left to take care of them.
Was it hard to find transportation to get here? Was it hard to find transportation to come to the United States?
No, we had to have our papers. Everything had to get examinations coming here, and I took my visa right away because this way I could go back and forth. You know, coming here, yeah, you had your visa, you get your green card coming here. There was only by boat you could come. And I was 11 days seasick. I was seasick the whole time for 11 days. And I had to come in here. You had to have somebody sponsor. You have to have a job. You have a place to live. You need an address. Yes. And there were a lot of things what we not still today what you we not allowed to do. You make it or you don't. You know, no, there's no help. You came here, and you're on your own.
How old were you when you arrived in the United States?
I was 25.
25.
Yeah. Yeah, I was 25, yeah. I had $25 in my pocket.
You were rich.
Yeah, you're right, yes. As I said, you make it or you don't. No, you're on your own.
Did you come by yourself or did you come with someone else?
I came by myself. Yes, all by myself, yeah.
Sister.
I had my sister here and my cousin. They came before me.
So what was it like when you got here? You got to the United States, and then what did you do?
Yeah, first my sister said, no, you're going to stay with me for a week, and then you go to work. So we lived in, wherever we worked, we lived with them people.
What kind of work did you do?
It was housework for it. Yeah. Housework, you do the breakfast in the morning for them, and then you clean up, and then clean the house and whatever they wanted you to do. Then one day, half a day, you had off, and that was usually Wednesdays. And did you work?
Half a day, that's not much, is it?
That's no, for a week, no. Yeah, that's all we had, yeah.
So can you tell us a little bit about coming to the U.S. and when you met your husband?
Yep, I came here in December and 7th, and he came in, we didn't know us then. He came in February 5th, and we met about in September. And I met somebody for work and stuff. He still told me that I could, there's a bakery in town that I could, at Queens Village, and they were looking for workers. So I went there, applied for a job, and I got hired right away. And he worked there already. Then one lady said, oh, there's a lot of German boys here, you have to meet them. So I was on the line for packing cakes and cookies, and then they all came by as say hi, bye, and that was it. So we met on the dance floor. That's where we met, almost a year later. It was September, and then they told me I should go to the boarding house up upstate New York. And then I worked there all summer long, from April to September in the boarding house, when I'm supposed to have help. No help. I did everything myself. We had about 21 rooms, some days to clean. Then I worked on the waitress on the table and cleaned up, and then back to work. And then I got a job in New York City in a restaurant as a waitress at Stouffer's restaurant. And then I worked there until I met my husband for there. And then we met in the little Switzerland. It was a little dance place there. And it was so strict that you could not go there unless you were dressed properly. And by the guys, they could rent their clothes if they were not dressed properly, a jacket or some whatever they needed for the occasion.
So what about your husband? Where was he from? And was he in the war?
No, they didn't. He went. He's supposed to go in. Well, when he was here, no, he went through the war, but they didn't have too much there in the island. They didn't. But at nighttime, we had to keep all our windows really, really dark, closed, and no light change came out. That nobody could see any light. Only a little tiny flashlight or cigarette light that would throw the planes off. There was any light, they would drop bombs right away. They did one time, they dropped a bomb right in front of the house, almost 300 meters from the house. We were going out in the bunkers, and I was, and the planes were low. They were going to go to Hamburg, and there was a thunderstorm, and they could go. And they must have seen lights somewhere. And we were outside, get out in the bunker. No, we couldn't. Here's a plane up, right up above us, unhook the bombs. I still hear them today, unhooking the bombs. And then off they went, and then they had to, and then we had about 20 small bombs going, and they cut the trees in half. They had, in the Christmas tree, they went, it flat, and they cleaned all the Christmas tree. And a big, it's just a half circle or flat. And then we hear the splinters from the bombs. They were flying over the house, they were in the house, and when one window broke from us. That's all we had, but in around the trees, they were all damaged from the splinters. We had scary, scary nights. Especially at nighttime when the planes came around. You had to be dressed ready every night. You had to have your clothes ready in case emergency, you had to get out. And I'm doing it still today. It was so long, and we just have to be ready for any emergency that you can go out anytime and anywhere. And daytime, sometimes you could see, we watch the planes, you would count them, how many they are in the groups. Especially one had 9, they had 15 in a group, and then there were thousands of them going into the city, from the cities, into Hamburg.
This might be a difficult question to answer, but can you tell me how the typical German felt when they realized what was going on in the camps? Because I'm sure you all were not aware of the tragedies that were happening. But how did that unfold throughout your village and the people you knew? How did they react?
Everybody reacted strange, very strange and scary. How come we didn't know? How come we don't know? They were doing at nighttime, you hear a lot of, you know, going nuts, going on for trucks driving around, but you were not allowed to allowed out. And nobody knew about it. No, and then they felt, how come we didn't know? How come we don't know? That's just, we can't answer that. That they very, very scary, quiet, and you can't talk about it. And it's hard to explain, very hard to explain. We didn't know. We didn't know. Then we hear something after that. We had no papers, we had nothing. And after newspapers or anything like that. But after that, it cleared up and we hear about it. We couldn't believe it. Is it true? Is it really true? You see it on pictures where they showed, where they have the camps, but then that was all in English and others, but not in German, so the Germans couldn't read it. No. The Americans got there first, so we had to believe what they tell us. Nobody could believe it. It's very, very, very scary it was. Yes.
Before you figured out what was going on in Germany, did you, you know, think?
Okay.
her.
Oh, okay.
She didn't know how to word it. She wanted to know if other people you knew really celebrated Hitler before the war started. I know I'd asked you personally what your family thought, but I think she's wanting to know, in general, did people really admire him as a as the whole German people?
Register, but we had to.
Okay.
You were told to. You have to have a meeting, you have a place to meet, you have to go there. You have to get dressed in the white blouse, and you had that, what you swastika, you call it. You had to have wear that. We had to destroy everything after the war. You have to, had to wear that, and you had to do that.
Were things in school taught in a way that would cause you all to be in line with what Hitler had in mind? How did the school, your schooling, handle it?
We handled it just so we didn't, nobody knew. We had to do as we told, and nobody knew. And our teachers, they didn't come back, they were all in. We didn't have the right teachers. They were substitutes. We knew more than they did. Sometimes there was. Yeah, that's what we did. We knew the answers, but we knew the teacher didn't know. So, yes.
How did the local church in Germany respond to the war? What did it preach about the Third Reich and the Allies, and how did it respond to the destruction that was occurring? How did your local church respond to the war, both in terms of what it said about it and how they responded to help the community?
We didn't have stuff like that. The church was the Lutheran church. Everybody was Lutheran. We only had one church, and we all were going to that one church, everybody, for the whole community. And no, they didn't. We had every Sunday, they had services. If there was somebody fallen, sometimes three, and then they were. Every Sunday, they were. The clothes were hung up. And that's all. Now, otherwise, there was never anything said about that. Not in church, we don't have that. And now another cross went up, another cross. It was very, very hard.
So nobody was allowed to talk about anything. You
were, you never, if you would say something, somebody would hear it, right? And then they would, bingo, where were you? You would pick up. I'm okay.
By the way, I'm her daughter, Maria.
No, that was nobody was ever said anything, was allowed to talk, or afraid to talk. Because somebody would ever hurt you, or there was translated a little bit different, you were on. You know, there were too many, and the Nazis especially, you never know.
Do you think that your experience of the war, because of where you lived in a, as you say, you know, a very small, you know, only two houses.
Yes.
Very small. Do you think that the war, you know, maybe touched your area less than a lot of places?
Yeah, they were. Yeah, they touched us. They were afraid. They were sometimes when they came over first they moved in. The water came closer and closer, and they were afraid there was something hiding by us. But then they took people from town, and they had to go with them and prove them to them that it was not. This was not so. It was, but. There was really too small, and there was not. There was We had a small woods around it. There was two houses, and then it was open fields. It was all opened. The woods were a little bit further away. It was a little bit hard to do something like there. But we don't know for the other where the camps were. We couldn't believe it. We could not believe they were so close, and there was so much behind it, so close to home.
And when the war ended, did American soldiers come to where you lived, where your family lived?
Yeah, that was 6 weeks later when we saw the first American came to. Oh, they were mainly eggs for their kitchen, but for them to eat. And then they were trading flour for that. We would get flour for them or something, and they took the eggs. And there was in other places, they would take over the houses, right? And then you have to move out to retake over. And then, it was 6 weeks after when they came to see us. They stayed in town, and then they came more often.
Did they ever take over your home?
No.
Never.
No. We were too far away from town. We were too they stayed closer to towns, yes.
We have a question back here. Ma'am, was your home in East after the war, was it in West Germany or East Germany or?
No, we were in West Germany.
West Germany.
We were in West Germany, yes.
And did you have Russian soldiers prisoners that came?
They had Russian prisoners. Yeah, then afterward they got let loose, and then they would come and start, they'd come to the houses and looking for something, yeah. But they had machine guns, so you had to be careful. You didn't know what they're going to do. And it's scary when they put you against the wall, machine gun in front of you, like, who is going to be first?
So those were the Russian prisoners of war?
Yeah. But they were nice people, the Russians, at that time, who were there. What else?
Let's see. Well, tell you what. Let's all, firstly, let's thank Herta Heine for shared a lot of things that are some very difficult memories, some pleasant memories, and some very difficult memories. And maybe if it's okay with you, maybe we can ask you a few more questions.
Yes,
and open it up a little bit, or unless there's anything else that you have off the top of your head that you'd like to say.
Not at the moment.
No. Okay. Well, if anything crops up, you just go ahead.
I will do that.
So do we have more questions? Yeah, over here.
What made you come here?
That's a good question. We had our homes, they never get sold. They're going from family to family. So I stayed at home, I had to work. So my father said, well, you go to school early. It was 5 years when we started just going to school. Then you come out a little earlier for work. So now I stayed home, I had to work. And my brother, when he came home from prison, so after a couple of years later, he got me, found a lady, he was getting married. I had to get out. So she took my place. They stay right in a home with the parents, with my parents and his parents. And she had to take my place, and I had to get out.
And you were how old?
I was 25.
You were
25. I was 25. I had to leave home.
Good questions?
There's one. What's the name of your village?
Brake. You call it brake. It's a brake on your cars, right?
B-R-A-K-E.
It's Brake. And we had to go to school in Boydson. It was the closest. We belonged to Stadler. And from Wenzel, we got our electricity.
From what I understand, your village was between the cities of Hamburg and Bremen.
We are right in the middle from Hamburg to Bremen. We are right in the middle.
Very After we're finished here, you can look at some of the maps back there, and you can see the area where the village was.
Yes. Yes.
Mm-hmm. Was it hard to get used to being in the United States?
Not hard at all. I adjust very, very quickly. It was not hard at all. For it was easy. I was used to hard work.
And was when you left Germany when you were 25, was there still rationing of food and things like that?
That was all over.
Okay, by that time.
Yeah, that was right after the war. We had everything, just like that. It was everything. The ships were on the way already. They brought from here up to Hamburg. Mm. It was not long then we had coffee, the real coffee. Yeah, we had to make our own from grain. We went on the stove. We had these coffee, what they called it. They have a different name for that. To make the brown, roast the coffee. Right?
Roast it,
right? Yes. And then they had to smoke. It's just like a strainer. You strain applesauce, almost like that. You put the coffee in, and then you on the stove until it's brown enough. Yeah, we use grain for that thing. Yeah, barley the most, and that was our coffee. And then we had now to make a cake and stuff. Then that's what we use for making. Put that in the cake. I haven't had no any other ingredients, so coffee grounds are good for cake.
Have you been back to visit since you came to the U.S.?
Pardon me?
Have you been back to Germany to visit?
Yes, back to Germany, and I was no citizen. You had to go to the IRS, make sure your taxes are paid up to date. If you didn't, you couldn't come back. They had to have our taxes. They had to be paid up to date.
And then were you left over there?
And when I became a citizen, I didn't have to do that no more.
When?
I was in 72.
Mm-hmm. You became a U.S. citizen.
Yeah. It was easier traveling, too.
What
happened after New York? So
you were telling us that you met your husband in New York and your different jobs there. Then what?
Then, yep. He worked in New York in a butcher shop, John Krause. And I think there's still some around. I think he's still in business. And then we moved to New Jersey. And that was 1963, right when Kennedy was assassinated, The television was on last and first off. So that they couldn't watch some television and the movies,
One of my children wants to know how old your brother was when he got married and you had to leave home.
Oh, I have to think back.
He's the oldest. Okay.
He's
still
old. He's 94. He's still alive. And I,
So how old would he have been when you moved down?
She's 95. So he was 30?
How old was
Uncle Hans?
He was 30. Now when he came back, what was it? He's from 23 to 49.
How many years older was he?
He's 7 years older than me. Yeah, 7 years. So he was 32. Yeah, 32.
Other questions? Sam.
When you came to the U.S., did you experience any xenophobia where you were treated poorly because of the attitude towards Germans after the war, or was what did that look like? Were you ever treated badly because you were German?
No, we were treated very, very nicely. Mm. No, we were very nicely treated. No, there was nobody against us or anything. No, we could go any place. It's so safe, you know. At nighttime, I could go by myself on a train or stop anywhere, wherever I want to go. And 3 o'clock in the morning, whatever, and nobody will bother you. Yeah, that's not safer than it's today. It's just so funny. Yeah. Now, if you go anywhere, any place by yourself, at any time, or nobody would bother you or do anything.
You have a question?
Did you have any pets?
Oh, we had horses, we had cows, yes, we had ducks, we had geese.
Chickens.
We had a lot of chickens. But yeah, we had to work with them. They were really pets we didn't have. We had a dog, yes. But we had a curfew. We had, by 7 o'clock, we had to be in the house at all times. This was also before the war. 7 o'clock, the kids off the road. They had up to 14, 15, 16. We have 8 years of school. We had school from 7 in the morning in the summertime, from 7 to 11, 12, or 1. And in winter time, we go from 8 o'clock to at same time, 11, 12. And had one classroom from 1st to 8th grade, all in one room. In the afternoons on Mondays, then we had from 3 to 5, we had sewing class. That's when we learned how to sew, to knit, crochet, whatever, weaving, whatever we had to do. We had to make our own clothes. For our hope chest, you see what you get it. There's no, that we have showers or anything. You have to have everything yourself. By the date and marriage, you have to have your closet full with linen, whatever you need.
Would you be able to save any of that?
Yeah, during the war, they made their own linen. I still have some linen, and anybody would like to see it from my mother. It's now, I would say, over 100 years old. And during the war, they had to donate that. I was taking from them. Then everybody knew who had linen. And they came, oh, we need that. Should we put the, and then they were just saying, burl up in their wounds. So they had their linen, they had to give their linen up. All that hard work, what they did, they had to give that up. But my mother kept hers. She came from a different town. They didn't know that she had it.
So they used those for bandages and things like that.
Yeah, that's what they really did. We don't know, but that was taken from the yeah.
Hurry to tell them how old you are.
I'm 87.
tell them your job now. Still working.
I'm still working. Yeah. I'm still working just about around the clock. Sometimes I'd be 17, 18 hours on the sewing machine, strictly sewing. Then I need a day for cutting, but then I do knit and crochet also.
Did you make what you're wearing?
Thank you for taking time out of your your sewing schedule for us.
Yeah.
Did you make the dress that you're wearing?
No. I can take it apart, but I should do this. But we need this. This is a little bit loose, but we need this for dancing. Oh. Otherwise, you lift your dress up for dancing. This has to be a little loose now.
So who do you sew for? Like, how do you sell your things that you're selling? Are you selling for a company or?
Yes, in New Jersey. They go to New Jersey and they distribute it. Wherever has.
Yep. Tell them what it is, Mom.
They are bonnets.
But they're not bonnets. You have to explain, Mom.
They are like hairnets. Hairnets from made from tulle. I use a lot of tulle and binding by thousands, shots of thousands, yeah. I need 500 shots to start with, 2,000 shots of this.
So,
that's
a lot.
So when do you think you're going to retire?
Never.
Right, never going to retire.
People didn't let me retire. The oldest somebody said, can't you do this for me? Can't you do that for me? I do anything. Nothing is too big, too small, too fancy, nothing. I do anything.
Okay, maybe we'll do one or two more questions.
You had told him something about a barn next door back in Germany.
I think Maria mentioned it.
Barn mm-hmm. next door.
Next to the living quarters. It's a barn.
Oh, yeah. Explain how the house is, how your house is. It's not a normal house.
Oh, okay. The houses we live in is part barn and part house. And when I got this, when we bought our double wide, I asked, where is the firewall? Firewall, what's that? I said, every house needs a firewall. Because one part of the house is a fire, so we not go into the other part. Now we live in part of the house. We have our bedrooms, living room, kitchen. Then there's a firewall, there's just a door going through and go in the barn. As if we had a small room, washroom in between, and then there's another door we go into the barn. That's where our cows and horses are. But the pigs are in there, then we had some pigs there, but most of them are in a different barn, the pigs. It's all on the one roof, but a firewall is a must.
So if the fire starts in the barn, it won't spread to the house.
Right.
All right, one more question. Yes.
In the village that you grew up, did you feel before you moved to America, did you feel you learned anything or had any perceptions about America that learned, like in the area that you were, that you felt when you came here you were surprised or changed your mind, just perceptions on American culture?
No, I had no problems. I could, nothing worried me really at that time. It was forgotten because the war is, we have nothing to do with it. We get told, this is it. You live with it. And coming here, no, that didn't, not at all, no. But the American people who came to see us, the soldiers, they were very nice. There's war. You know, they fight. But we have nothing to do with it. We have to live with it. We had to go through with it and do the best you can. No matter how hard it is and what, then you live through with it.
Well, I'd like to thank Herta Heine. Please join me in thanking her.
I thank everybody for coming. I did a bad job, I think.
At the back there's photo albums, there are maps and things like that you can see more about Herta's life. And thank you all for coming. And I hope you'll come to other lectures. Thank you all very much.
Anybody like to come to see me, be glad to.
I'm sure she'd be happy to talk with you.
The door is open.